بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا ربي لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا ولمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسولا. So this is the third episode or the third installment of سيدنا إبراهيم, the story of سيدنا إبراهيم inshallah. And the first one we discussed how there were three types of worship. And how Ibrahim alayhi salam was able to show people that they were wrong, and then what they did to him, and then his absolute reliance only on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Jibreel came to him and said, "Do you want anything?" He said, "Not from you, only from Allah." Last week we talked about how Sayyidina Ibrahim was in order by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to slaughter his son, to sacrifice, to slaughter his son. And we discussed what sacrifice is and what sacrifice is not, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then bestowed them with a ransom. He brought them a ransom, i.e. the one that was asking for the child was the one that paid the ransom, not the parent. And we also talked about how Sayyidina Hajar would go from Safa and Marwa 7 times, and the meaning of Taqwa and the meaning of reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Ismail, the son of Ibrahim, is known as the ransomed one. He's known as the ransomed one. And this is a really big thing, yeah? A really, really big thing. Because who ransomed him? We mentioned this last time. It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that ransomed him. And sometimes we think that when we come to sacrifice something, we're losing. But we don't lose anything. And not only do we not lose anything, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers us with prestige. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers us with His mercy, showers us with so much more than we could have ever hoped for. So now we know Him to eternity as the ransomed one, ransomed by Allah. Allah not only didn't want His life, he didn't want Him to be killed or harmed or anything like that. He then brought something as a gift from the heavens on behalf of this sacrifice that Ibrahim alayhi salam was going to give. We also discussed how Ismail was asked, his father asked him, "What do you think?" And we said that one of the lessons from that is, first of all, the relationship between father and son, such that a father would say to his son, "Allah has asked me to do this, what do you think?" And the son would turn around and say, do what you have been ordered, commanded to do. So this is a really, really beautiful relationship between father and son. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, the days pass and he's not with Ismail. He doesn't live with Ismail. And Ismail grows up and he gets married. He's living with his mother in the Arabian Peninsula and he gets married. And his father misses him, so his father goes to visit him. And there are also isharat, there are signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously, is going to ask Ismail to help him do something. So there are isharat, there are signs that this was all planned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously, and that Ibrahim had been asked to go visit his son, Ismail. So Ibrahim goes to visit his son Ismail, and he knocks on the door of their house, and a woman answers. A woman answers the door. And he says, "Is Ismail here?" And the woman replies, "No, he's not here." So Ibrahim, the father, the loving father, he says, "How are you? How are things?" The wife, she says, "Things are harsh, things are tight. We don't really have that much. You can see the place isn't that big. And yeah, he works hard, comes back, but we're struggling." Now she doesn't know that this man is Ibrahim alayhi salam. She doesn't know that this is her father-in-law. She has no idea that this is her father-in-law. Some random man, to her he's random, comes and says to her, "How are you doing?" And the woman, the wife, replies by saying, "Things are a bit hard, well, we're making it through, but it's a struggle." Ibrahim alayhi salam, her father-in-law, though she doesn't know that he's her father-in-law, he says, "Okay, when your husband comes back, tell him that I was asking for him, and tell him to change his doorstep." tell him to change his doorstep. Now, what is a doorstep? This is a kinaya, it's a nickname, right, for the person that answers the door. So if a son had answered the door, Ibrahim would have said, you know, obviously you can't change your son, but if he wanted to say something, or your servant, you know, a maid or a servant opened the door, and they were being a bit rude, and Ibrahim would have wanted to say to Ismail, change the, you know, your helper here, change your butler, right? Then he would have said, change your doorstep. Because what it means is the person that answers the door, change it. Now some sisters, and some brothers as well, think that, oh, he's making woman equal to doorstep. It has nothing to do with that. It just means the person that answers the door. First thing you see. So, Ismail comes back after a hard day of work, and he says, you know, what's happened, how are things? And he's like, oh yeah, a very handsome old man came to see you. What does he look like? She described how he looked. Did he say anything? Yeah, he asked how we're doing. And then he said, change your doorstep. He said, this is my father, and he has ordered me to divorce you. And we're going to come into why later. But just to remind you, this woman doesn't know who this man is. Some random guy comes, knocks the door, how are you doing? Oh, things are hard, and she's complaining. What's this? What's going on? She doesn't know this is her father-in-law. She knew this was her father-in-law. Fine, different story altogether, but she doesn't know. Then Ismail, I said, gets married to second, another wife. Not at the same time, another wife. Different, a later stage, sequential, not parallel. And he, again, he's away, he's working, and Ibrahim Aleyhisselam comes, he knocks the door, his wife opens the door. Where is your husband? He's out, he's working. Okay, well, how are you? How are you doing? How are things? She says, Alhamdulillah. Allah has bestowed us, everything is good. Alhamdulillah, there's nothing that we want that we don't have. Everything is tranquil between us. Allah has bestowed us with mercy. Look at the difference. She doesn't know who this man is. She doesn't know this is her father-in-law. She's not trying to, you know, play goody-goody. Yeah, she doesn't know who this guy is. He's just a man, old man, coming, knocking the door. Another thing is that he's old. He looks old, right? So sometimes, you know, you open up to someone who looks old, you know, some auntie, grandmother comes along, you know, you open up to her with women, or the same thing will happen with a granddad, etc. So he looks old, so they open up to him. But this one is different. The second one is very different. Very different. He says, everything is good. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. He says, tell your husband to keep his doorstep. Again, meaning the person that opens the door. So Ismail comes back. How are you? How have things been? Anything, you know, did anything happen? Oh, this handsome man came by. What does he look like? He looks like such and such. Oh, that's my father. What did he tell you? He said, keep your doorstep. He said, this is my father, and he told me to keep you, and that you are a wife that is worthy. Now I say worthy, why? Why? Who is Ismail? Who is Ismail? You see, some people deserve a woman who's difficult to get along with, because they're difficult to get along with. Some people deserve a woman that, you know, You wish you didn't even know her in the first place. But khalas, you married, you got children. Other wife, but the husband is very similar. Usually, why? Because of tayyibat and tayyibun. The good women are for the good men, and the good men are for the good women. And the bad women are for the bad men, and the bad men are for the good women. This is a principle that we know, and it's in the ayahs of the Quran. But Ismail, who is Ismail? Ismail is the one who gave us Zamzam. From birth. He is a very special, very, very special person, and a prophet. Then he gets older, and his father says, I have, you know, my Lord has ordered me to sacrifice you, slaughter you. He says, do as you wish. This is not someone who's difficult to get along with. This is someone who will give up everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't deserve someone like that. But there's an even more important thing. Sometimes when you come to leave home, or the woman wants to do, you know, leave home. This isn't just about brothers or sisters, both. They want to do something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it doesn't contradict the life of the family or anything like that. The husband will say, no, you can't go to the mosque. Why can't I go to the mosque? The Prophet says, do not prohibit This the maid girls of Allah, i.e. the female servants, i.e. all females, the one who go to the mosque, from going to the mosque. The Prophet said this. Umar radiallahu anhu was a very jealous man. One of his wives would always go to the mosque. He was jealous, and everyone could see on his face that whenever he saw in the mosque, he looked jealous, he looked angry. So they said to him, "Why don't you tell him not to go? Tell her not to go." He said, "How can I tell her not to go when the Prophet told us not to tell the woman not to go to the mosque?" So what did he do? He used to stand behind a wall, or behind a tree or a bush. He used to take little pebbles, and as she walked past, he'd throw them at her. Right? To tease her, to make her think that someone is teasing, flirting with her. Now he's being very literal. He didn't tell her. Yeah? He didn't tell her, he didn't speak to her, tell her not to go. But he wanted to make her not go. But without telling her, out of the respect they have for the Prophet. So she comes back, and then the next time the next prayer comes along, and Umar says, "You're at home, why are you not going?" She says, "Oh, times are not like the times used to be with the Prophet. You know, people were throwing stones at me, i.e. being flirtatious." So you see how even Umar wouldn't stop his wife from going to the mosque, wouldn't say to her, "You can't go to the mosque." And the rest is how, but this wasn't the case. Noah said, "Don't go to the," and the Prophet sallam, and the woman would pray in the front, and the men would pray in the front, right? And the woman would pray in the back, and no one would say anything. And it was the woman that asked later, "Ya Rasulullah, make us a different door, because when we were walking, we were, it's not nice, make us a different door." And he made it, alayhi salatu wasalam. All of this to say that when a woman who is good is with a husband who's like that, it's not very nice. And when a man who is good, he's taking care of the kids, he's bringing them, he's spent time, quality time with family, with children, with everything, and then he comes to go out, and he goes, "Where are you going?" Khalas, it's a war now. And even if he says, "I'm going anyway," but it's not nice. It's not nice. What is this, man? You're my prison guard or something. What's going on? In either case, a man shouldn't stop the woman from leaving the house to go to the mosque, and the man shouldn't be stopped by the woman either. Another thing is that obviously different people have different duties. So the man's duty is, and this, Allah has to do with law, Allah has to do with customs and traditions, etc. So we won't go into it. But so long as everyone is doing their duty, people should be easy with each other. People should be easy with each other. So Ibrahim is about to ask Ismail to help him do something so important. So important. He asks Ismail, and this is why Ismail needs to have a good wife. Because the task he's about to ask him to help him with is not going to take a day or two or a week or a month. It's going to take a long, long while. So he needs a good wife. He needs someone that's not going to get out of his way. Someone that's not going to cap him. And this is, you can derive from this a principle that when you come to have a team that's going to work for da'wah, or a team that's going to, you've opened up a business, and the money you earn from that business you want to give to charity. Good. But don't employ people that have no qualifications as part of your business in the name of charity. Because it doesn't work. You won't earn any money, you'll be losing. Yeah? You'll be losing. That's how it works, isn't it? That's how it works. My cousin wants to work with me, but my cousin doesn't know how to read. And I'm doing this and that. You need to write and read. If I hire him as charity, then he's gonna get in the way. And the business will suffer, and then I can't pay more charity outside. But if I give him charity and he's not part of my business, yeah, so long as he can't harm my business, then it's fine. So Ibrahim wants to make sure, that his son Ismail is with a wife who will not stop him, who will not cap him. They're about to do something extremely important. Ibrahim asks his son. He says, "Allah has ordered me to do something. Will you help?" "Will you help?" Now he leaves it open. Now maybe, if one of us had been asked, if we were the son of Ibrahim, and my Lord has asked me to slaughter you, and then 20, 25 years later, same guy, your father comes along and says, "Allah has asked me to do something," you go, "Oh, not again." Okay, do we go through this once? No, He says, whatever he has ordered you to do, then let's do it. He doesn't say what. See, Ibrahim leaves it open, he doesn't specify. And Ismail doesn't ask for him to specify. He just says, what? Let's go ahead, let's go with it, without asking more. Then Ibrahim says, he has asked us to build a house here. To build a house here. And as we know, this is Al-Kaaba. This is the house of Al-Kaaba. This, today is all about sincerity. Today is all about sincerity. Yeah. The whole life of every prophet is about sincerity. But inshallah, you're going to see something today that really shines through. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ibrahim al-qawaid min al-bayt. And Ibrahim brings up the foundations of the house, i.e. of the Kaaba. Why? Because they were laid before. They were laid before. And Adam used to do tawaf around the Kaaba, alayhi. But then with time, it disappeared and people didn't know where it was. So Ibrahim alayhi isn't building something new. He is only bringing up the foundations that were already there. What is Ismail and his son Ismail? This is so weird. This is so weird. What is about to happen, what they say now. Ibrahim and Ismail are building the house of Allah because Allah asked them to. Is that sincerity? Does anyone here think that's insincere in any way? Sincere, right? Allah asks you to do something, you'll do it. And then, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. Our Lord, accept from us. أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. You are the one that hears the all-knowing. Whilst partaking in a sincere act, they are asking Allah to accept from them. It's sincerity within sincerity. Whilst partaking in the act, they are asking Allah to accept from them. Is that not strange? Why am I building a random house in the middle of the desert? And who am I doing this for? And later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks Ibrahim to make adhan so the people come. Ibrahim says, how, ya Allah, how will people hear me? And Allah responds and he says, just you make adhan and we'll make people hear you. So Ibrahim has no idea that this will become a very famous place and that he will be mentioned for eternity. There's no reason to build a random house in a desert like that, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked you to do so. Why then say, oh Allah, accept from us? Why make dua to be sincere when you're doing something that can only be understood as the peak of sincerity? Sincerity within sincerity. And this is something really important. Sincerity has no bounds. Sincerity has no bounds. Why does sincerity have no bounds? Sincerity is not limited. It's not limited. Yeah? Sincerity is not limited. It has no bounds. Even whilst being sincere, they're asking Allah to make them sincere. Because sincerity has got to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who here knows what Surah Al-Ikhlas is? Who doesn't know what Surah Al-Ikhlas is? Surah Al-Ikhlas, yeah? One of the four quls. قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا. It's called Surah Al-Ikhlas. Ikhlas means sincerity. It's called the chapter of sincerity, but when you read it, it has nothing to do on the outset with sincerity. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say, He is the one, God. اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ, the everlasting, the almighty. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. He doesn't give birth and he's not begotten. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. And nothing is like him. Or no one is like him. So where's sincerity got to do with this? Why is it called the chapter of sincerity? When he's discussing the attributes of Allah. When he's telling us the attributes of Allah. Why? Because once you understand the attributes of Allah, that he's always present as Samad. There was no beginning to him and there will be no end. He is not begotten. He was always there, he's not begotten. I was begotten, you were begotten. Therefore we owe our existence to something else, to someone else. Allah doesn't owe his existence to anything. He does not produce children, he does not have children. Again, this is out of his might and power. He doesn't need to have a child. I need to have a child because when I die, who's going to carry on the lineage? Who's going to take my money? Who's going to take this? Allah doesn't die. Doesn't need a child. When you know these characteristics of Allah, it doesn't make sense to do anything for anyone except Allah. This is why it's called Surah Al-Ikhlas, the chapter of sincerity. Because why would I do it for you if you're going to betray me in 2 years? You're going to die. If you don't betray me, you're going to die. Or I'm going to die. And then you can't help me in my grave, or I can help you in your grave. It doesn't make sense to do anything except for Allah. Because He's the everlasting. These are His attributes, and this is why it's called Al-Ikhlas. Because once you know Allah truly, there's no way that you would pray for anyone except for Allah. No way. Why would you do so? The dumbest thing. This is why it's called Surat Al-Ikhlas. So they're there, and they're being sincere within their sincerity. Why? Because they're getting closer and closer to Allah. And the closer and closer you get to Allah, the more sincere you are. And the closer you get, the more you realize that there's still some, there's more closeness to come. And so they ask for more sincerity to get closer to Allah. Do you understand? Allah is limitless, Allah is boundless. And so therefore your sincerity towards Him is also limitless and boundless. There's always more sincerity than you can achieve. Always. And so whilst they're there, building a house, a random house in the middle of nowhere, that they don't know what it's going to be used for, they don't know that thousands and millions of people are going to come to this place, they're still asking for sincerity because they know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We talked before about Ibrahim being the Khalil. Love, adore, totally adore. Khalil is like, you know, between him and Allah. There's a relationship between him and Allah. He's the Khalil of Allah. And only him and Muhammad have this relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they make a dua. رَبَّنَا وَجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ. So weird. Oh Allah, make us Muslims for you. Muslims mean that we submit. What are you doing? Is this not submission? What you're doing right now, is this not submission? And then you're asking Allah to accept from you? Is this not further submission? And then you say, oh Allah, make us from the submitters? Look at the sincerity, it knows no bounds. وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا. And from our offspring. And as we know, the lineage Muhammad is from this lineage, from this offspring. وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُوبَ عَلَيْنَا. And show us our rituals and forgive us. Repent, repent on us, or allow us to repent. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. You are the oft-forgiving, the most merciful. Another lesson. When you're doing good deeds, this is the perfect time to meet God. When you're doing good deeds, this is the perfect time to meet God. Two types of God. First of all, Allah, accept from me my deeds. That's the first type of God. Secondly, anything you want. Allah, you know, I don't want to get a mortgage. Give me a better job so I don't have to go into this thing for 25 years. What the hell? 25 years. Slavery. And that's why they call it mortgage, engagement till death. Mort, death. Yeah, most people, you'll buy a mortgage, then they've got like 20,000 left. Look at his wife and goes, we should buy a bigger house. You just have to finish your mortgage, man. And then they get another 200,000. Mortgage, engagement till death. This is usually what happens. Yeah, people are engaged till death. 25 years, you don't die by then. In the 22nd year, you want another engagement with death, right? A contract till death. So, two types of dua that we make when we're doing something. We make dua that Allah accepts, firstly, and secondly, we make dua for everything else. Because Allah, when you remember Allah, Allah remembers you. When you remember Allah, remember, and the Prophet ﷺ describes how, when we remember Allah, Allah remembers us in a gathering better than this one. Amongst angels, amongst prophets. We are remembering each other, other human beings, fellow sinners. But Allah mentions us as we mention Him in a gathering better than us. And something really important. Some people say, you know what, I don't want to pray in the mosque, because if I pray in the mosque, people will see me and that's insincere. It lacks sincerity. And this garbage is spewed from people's mouths all the time. I don't want to do that just in case I'm not sincere. Yeah? Just in case I'm not sincere. we're in a charity and they're asking for money. I'm not going to give right now, just in case someone sees me and I'm being insincere. This is not right. This is not right. And we're going to explain why. We're going to explain why. First of all, in order to be sincere, you have to be doing something. You can't be sincerely doing nothing. By definition, I'm sincerely drinking a cup of water. I can't be sincerely not doing anything. I'm sincerely praying. I can't be sitting down, not doing anything, and then saying, at least I'm not sincere. You're nothing. Do you understand? In order for there to be even a slight possibility of sincerity, you have to be doing something. There's no innama al-a'malu binniyat, right? Indeed, actions are but by intentions. I have an intention, but there's no action. If there's no action, then there's no intention. Yeah? And there's no intention. Especially with sincerity. You can't be sincerely doing nothing, so you have to be doing something. And this is a trick of the shaitan. Oh, don't do that. Don't do that. Yeah? Because people will see you, and then you start to like yourself, and then just don't do it. This is from the shaitan. And the ulama have said, he who is about to do something, and then does it because people are... Then this is insincerity, so yeah. But he who's about to do something and then stops himself from doing it because he's afraid that other people will see him and he'll be insincere, this is also insincerity. Because who are you doing it for? Sincerity means you're doing it for Allah. Allah. If you're not doing it for Allah, you're being insincere. So when you're doing something but you're not doing it for Allah, that's insincere. And when you're not doing something for someone else, that's also insincere. Because the intention is for someone else, in either case, whether you're doing it or you're not doing it. It's really important to bear in mind. The other thing with regards to sincerity, ulama al-maqasid, the scholars of maqasid. Maqasid means the objectives of Islam, right? The overarching outcomes that Islam wants to promote through the Sharia. The first is to safeguard religion. The first is to safeguard religion. The second is to safeguard life. The third is to safeguard honor and lineage together. The fourth is to safeguard the mind. And the fifth is to safeguard wealth. So first is religion, then is life, then is honor and lineage, fourth is the mind, and the fifth is wealth. You got that? Yeah? Fine. In this ilm, the ulama have said something really important. How do you know you're being sincere? And when does Allah accept your actions or your deeds? When does He accept them? They have two conditions. That your intention for Allah comes first. That's the first condition. The second condition is that your intention for Allah is greater than your intention for anything else. So I'm going to go to the mosque. And I'm going to meet my friends there. There are two intentions there, right? I'm going to go to the mosque and I'm going to meet my friends there. Two intentions. But which one comes first? Am I going to go to the mosque and, by the way, my friends are there? Or am I only going to pray in the mosque because I'm going to meet my friend? Does that make sense? So if you're going for the sake of Allah, then that's the first condition. The second condition has to be more than 50%. It has to be 51 or above percent. So if I'm going for the sake of Allah first, and this is the aghlabiyya, this is the majority of my intention, then I get rewarded. It's accepted from me. If I'm going for the sake of Allah first, but then my niyyah changes, and I'm actually going 60% for my friends and 40% for Allah, then it's not accepted. Does that make sense? So the first mission, niyyah, intention, has to come for the sake of Allah. Has to be for, and then secondly, the other condition has to be the greater percentage of it has to be for the sake of Allah. So, this is why sincerity knows no bounds. Because if you just do 51%, it's accepted from you when your sincerity is very high. If you do 95%, it's accepted from you when your sincerity is very high. And this is where people differ. Now if I'm going to go to the mosque for my friends, I'm not praying for my friends. Does that make sense? I'm not praying for my friends. I'm going to the mosque to meet my friends. Then the act of going to the mosque, I do not get rewarded for. But the act of prayer I do because I'm praying to Allah for Allah. And I was going to do that at home. But here's the thing. What a waste of a... I mean, I'm going anyway. And I'm going to walk there. I'm going to drive there, I'm going to cycle there, I'm going anyway. So how silly is it of me not to do it for the sake of Allah? Wasted time. Wasted. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiplies it by 24 or more times. Why would I not do that? And this brings us back to the issue of sacrifice that we talked about last week. You can get married for the sake of Allah. Or you can get married because you want to get married. Both are legitimate. Both are halal. No problem with that. But if you get married because you want to get married, then you're going to go through the ups and the downs of marriage, and you're going to die, and that's it. If you get married for the sake of Allah, then you're going to go through the ups and the downs, and every up will be rewarded, and every down will be rewarded, and every up will be rewarded, and every down will be rewarded, and every up will be rewarded, and every down. The same thing will happen. The same thing will happen. So sincerity really is the highest fruit of aqidah. Aqidah al-tawheed. The highest fruit of our creed, of knowing who Allah is that we achieve sincerity. This is the highest fruit. You're sitting here. I'm sitting here. Am I doing this for the sake of Allah, or am I doing it for something else? If I'm doing it for the sake of Allah, then I'll get rewarded. If I'm not doing it, then an hour will pass, half an hour will pass. It will pass anyway, but no reward. Yeah. And this is the difference between someone that's able to invest their time and their niyyah and their intentions for the sake of Allah. We all have the same amount of resources. All of us. If you have more time, then I have more money. If I have more money, you have more time, or more this, or more that, more children. And we all have exactly the same amount of investment. If we invest it, all we get, but no. Some of us invest our intentions, some of us don't. And then there's this other thing. And this is really important, because we're talking about the relationship between a father and a son. I was speaking, a sister asked me in a forces conference, I said, you have to love each other for the sake of Allah. And she kind of, her face went like, I said, is there a problem with that? She said, it's kind of offensive that someone loves me for the sake of Allah. I want him to love me for me. Right? And I said, okay, that's nice. And some of the brothers, you know, it's not a sister thing, some brothers feel exactly the same thing. There was a sister who had the guts to show me her, you know, to put that face. Pull that face. So, is that true? That if someone loves you for the sake of Allah, that means they don't really love you. They love Allah because Allah asks, you know, that's why they're treating you nice. Is that true? Or is it false? That's the question. Is it true or is it false? True or false? Come on, gentlemen, ladies. Ladies first, ladies last today. Is it true or false? I'm going to stop bullying people and making faces. Is it true that if you love someone for the sake of Allah, this is not as much love as you could have loved them if you had loved them for them? Both. What does that mean? Okay, so the love might be for Allah. Someone okay. I'm not talking about putting up with them for the sake of Allah. I'm saying loving someone for the sake of Allah. Most people, a lot of people think this. Sincerity knows no bounds. And so therefore your love for them would know no bounds. Whereas, if you love them because you love them, you know, she's pretty today, she's ugly tomorrow. Yeah. He's a good friend today, I can rely on him, tomorrow I can't. Something happens. Yeah. So there's no bounds. when you love someone for the sake of Allah, it's not limited by anything. But when you love someone because they're good to you, or because you like a characteristic within them, then once that characteristic changes, maybe your love will change. Yeah? That's exactly, that's the answer. And subhanAllah, when you see this, Yusuf alayhi salam, he loved for the sake of Allah, as we were taught earlier. He loved for the sake of Allah. And so when he was in prison, and he saw these two criminals, he wasn't a criminal, but they were criminals. And he said, help us, we see you of the good people. He helped them, why? Because he loves Allah. And he loves them for the sake of Allah. So it's really, really important to think, oh, you don't really love me, you love me for, you know, you love me for the sake of Allah. If you think that, you're being daft. Because not only does he love you, he loves you even more for the sake of Allah. This knows no bounds. Prophet ﷺ describes how there are people who are good to you when you're good to them. And then, if something changes, all of a sudden they're your worst enemy. Your worst enemy, not just like a non-good friend, they're your worst enemy. And the Prophet ﷺ describes how this is from the prophets. This means they didn't love you for the sake of Allah. It means they didn't love you for the sake of Allah. And while we're on this subject, of the seven people that will be on the shade, under the shade of Allah, when there will be no shade, are people that loved each other for the sake of Allah. Are people that loved each other for the sake of Allah. And this knows no boundaries. So much so, brothers and sisters, that my son is my son. But what's the difference between my son and your son? Really? Really, what's the difference? Genetics? If I love my son for the sake of Allah, then I will treat him very well. If I love your son for the sake of Allah, then your son is my son. Yeah? There's no racism. There's no scarcity. Because Allah is boundless. And anything you do for Allah is boundless. And we see now that they're building a house for Allah. A house for Allah. And they're being sincere in doing so. And then they're asking Allah to grant them sincerity. And then they're asking Allah to make them of the submitters. And Allah grants them the sincerity within sincerity within sincerity. And because of this, the magnitude of their sincerity, because of the magnitude of their sincerity, millions of people now go every year and do Hajj. Do you understand? Because of the magnitude of sincerity, we slaughter every year to remember what they did and the ransom that happened. Because of their sincerity. Because of their sincerity. There are books. There are books like 40 Nawawi. Many, many, many imams did 40 this, 50 that. But 40 Nawawi is known, almost everyone has it in their book. Why? It must be because of his sincerity when he was writing this. It must be. Why his book and no one else's? Because of his sincerity. And so sincerity knows no bounds. And so when you love someone for the sake of Allah, this means you love them more than you would have if you didn't. By definition. And if you think you love someone for the sake of Allah, then they change and you change when you didn't love them for the sake of Allah. And this is one of the ways you know whether you're being sincere or not. You see, I'm going to the mosque for Allah, but my friends are there as well. After 2 years, you know, I'm always meeting my friends. After 6 months, one of them goes to Leeds, another one goes to, you know, Manchester, may Allah forgive him. Another one goes to London. Yeah, I don't like Manchester. Okay, so now I don't have any friends that go to the mosque. I stopped going to the mosque. Now I know that maybe I wasn't sincere. My sincerity changed. I was sincere, but remember I said I asked more than 51%. That went down to 50, 49, 48, 45, 40. This is why whilst they're doing the act, they're asking Allah to make them sincere. See how important it is? Whilst you're doing that, sincerity is the most important thing. And is the ultimate, the peak, the best fruit that comes from tawheed. ربنا وابعث فيهم رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياتك ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة ويزكيهم إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم. Our Lord, send to them or send within them a messenger from amongst them. So it's Ismail Nabi, from his lineage, the Arabs, from amongst them. يتلو عليهم آياتك, that he would recite upon them your ayahs. The Quran, you, the ayahs, and to teach them the book, وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ, تَزْكِيَة, to purify, to beautify. تَزْكِيَة has two meanings, to purify and to beautify. When you have water and it has sand in it, it's not very beautiful. But as you purify the water of the sand, the water becomes beautiful, right? The water becomes, but if you take the water and add sand in it, and you go, I'm not going to purify it, I'm just going to beautify it. I'm going to put some sugar in it. I'm going to put honey in it.
Yeah.
Okay. But as you still drink it, yeah, you made it beautiful, but the honey doesn't really take the sand away. So maybe it's even worse than before, because now the sand sticks to the honey, right? It's not nice. So he's saying to purify them and to beautify them. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Indeed, you are the most dignified, the most wise. The most dignified, the most wise. And subhanAllah, who can make a dua? Who can make a dua? That Allah sends from His offspring messengers and prophets. Who makes this dua? From Ismail, Muhammad Islam. From Ishaq, all the Jewish prophets that you know after him. Who makes this dua? And look how sincere they must have been that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them this. It's amazing. You read Surah Ali Imran, the family of Imran. The mother makes a dua. She makes a dua. Oh Allah, here is my daughter for you. She makes a dua out of sincerity. Oh Allah, accept my daughter. And subhanAllah, Allah accepts her daughter and she becomes the Virgin Mary. She's so famous, everyone knows her because of the sincerity. And then she has a son, Isa. Prophets come out of the sincerity of the father or the mother. That's how important sincerity is. That's how important sincerity is. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spent in the Quran, for those of us that are afraid that when we die, we will leave children that are weak and no one will take care of them, the orphaned, the mother's weak, and our brothers and sisters are dead, or they're not good people or whatever, how are they going to fend for themselves? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we need, if we want to help them once we're dead, that we are sincere to Allah and we have taqwa in mind. So sincerity is your tool. I was going to say your weapon, but it has connotations of war. It doesn't have to be. But it's your tool. It's the thing that you build your future with and other people's future with. Sincerity. If you're sincere, things will open, inshallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts this dua from Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail also. You see, first of all, Ibrahim doesn't just, there's an athar, narration about him. I haven't checked the authenticity of it. But Ibrahim alayhi salam is making dinner and someone comes to eat from the food and he says to him, say Bismillah, say in the name of Allah. And the man, he says, I don't say this. Because remember what I said, there were only three people that believed in him, two or three people that believed in him. His wife, Lut, who became a prophet, and obviously his two children. And apart from that, very few people believed in him. And the Prophet ﷺ describes how the year after he will be prophets alone, no one believed him. No one believed him. Just random men coming like this, prophets or messengers, no one believed him. There would be some with two, some with three, some with 10, some with 50. So he says, okay, if you're not going to say Bismillah, then don't eat my food. Don't eat my food. The least you can do is say Bismillah. I'm asking for money, just say Bismillah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Ibrahim, I've been patient with this man for 40 years or more. I gave him everything he has, his breath, his lungs, every heartbeat, every ni'mah, every bounty he has, all the food up till when you fed him, before and after that. And he's not remembered me once, and he hasn't said Bismillah once. And I have not, and Allah has not stopped his bounties from him. So he's teaching Ibrahim that don't tell him not to eat your food just because he'll say Bismillah. But Ibrahim alayhi salam loves for people good. He says, say Bismillah. And the man wouldn't say it. So Ibrahim got jealous on behalf of Allah because he's the Khalil. Someone, you know, don't cheat my wife like that. Right? Or don't cheat my sister like, why are you looking at her like that? You get jealous over someone you love. Allah loves, Ibrahim loves Khalil, Allah. So he got jealous. He said, you don't need the khalas, don't you? Don't say Bismillah, don't you? But Allah reminds him. You see that Ibrahim wants to share with everyone. He doesn't stop with himself. He even gives his son the opportunity. What do you think? Allah wants me to start to you. What do you think? Why? So that his son can get the reward with him. So his son can get the reward with him. And same thing with the Kaaba. He doesn't just say, Allah has ordered me to build the Kaaba. Here, you're my son, come and do it. He gives him the opportunity. Why? Because of sincerity. And I'm going to end with the following. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا إكراه في الدين. There's no compulsion in religion. There is no compulsion in religion. Why? Because the religion means nothing without your intention, without your sincerity. It's just you're pecking the floor, you're making, you know, sujood and ruku', you're pecking the floor, that's it. It means nothing. Nothing. Now that doesn't mean that in an Islamic state people take a mic and they start drinking alcohol in the streets. No, they drink at home if they want to do that. Yeah, there are codes and regulations in every society and they follow it. Not because it's the deen, but because it's the state of the law of the land. Law of the land. But you can't compel someone to become Muslim. There's no compulsion in religion. There's no compulsion in religion. This is not what we understand. This is not the way that it's supposed to be. Why? Because of sincerity. Because it makes it equals nothing here. You know, they can do it, they can build a mountain where it equals nothing. جزاكم الله خيرا وكم الله بهذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم. إن شاء الله next week we're going to be the fourth and final part إن شاء الله in this series. If there are any questions or any comments, إن شاء الله we'll get 5 minutes. So the question is that some ulama, you mentioned in the Taymiyyah for example, say that you should have something you do alone that no one else knows about, that you do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to train yourself to be sincere and to guarantee or increase the chances of your sincerity being the case. And by the way, you've got to make sure when you do that sometimes when we're doing something in secret, we are doing it not because we want to do it for the sake of Allah. We're doing it because we want to feel good about ourselves. And this is a trap, a very, 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 very subtle trap. Don't do something because you want to feel good about doing it. And don't do something because you feel guilty for not doing it. Do something only for the sake of Allah. Only for the sake of Allah. Then you ask, are there any other things that we can do? This ayah actually teaches us. When you're doing something, yeah, say, Rabbana taqabbal. Oh my Lord, accept. When you're doing it, say, oh my Lord, accept. Even if you think you're doing it for Allah, say, oh my Lord, accept. Well, you're not going to lose anything. But what it does do is it solidifies the action. It solidifies the action. Why does it solidify the action? Because your intention can change. You go from 99 down to 70, down to 40. But when you say, oh Allah, accept my intention, accept my act, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you're doing a good deed, inshallah He will answer your prayer, answer your du'a, and will make it so that it's accepted because you're sincere. So that's the most important thing. Make du'a that you're sincere, and then whilst you're going to act, make du'a that you're sincere, and that Allah accepts. Any other questions?